and all the time. Now, I ask that this paper be passed around. If you have a copy, I just want to go over some quick information right there. Very simple paper. If you don't have one, you can share one right now. Kelua, you can just give to everyone that do not have a copy. It's so interesting that some of the world's greatest discoveries, world's greatest inventions were accidental. These were some of the inventions that people accidentally hit. They were not out to make these discoveries. There are so many more, but I just brought out a few that I can whet your appetite a little bit with. It will shock you to know that the man that invented the microwave in 1945 was not trying to invent a microwave. His name is Percy Spencer, an engineer to Raytheon. After his World War I stint in the army, he was known as an elite electronics genius. He was fiddling with a microwave emitting magnetron used in the guts of radar arrays when he felt a strange sensation in his pants. It was a sizzling in his pants. He just felt a jolt, and he paused and he found out that a chocolate bar in his pocket had started to melt. I didn't know that it was coming from the rays of the experiment. Figuring that the microwave radiation of the magnetron was to blame or to credit, as it would turn out, Spencer immediately set out to realize the culinary potential at work. That was how the microwave oven was invented. Skip on the saccharine, skip on the slinky. Play-Doh was another one that caught my attention. Quite a lot more. Before being found ground into the rugs of child-rearing homes everywhere, Play-Doh was ironically created to be a cleaning product. The paste was first marketed as a treatment for filthy wallpaper before the company that produced it began to go down the tubes. The discovery that started Couture Products headed for bankruptcy wasn't that their wall cleaner worked particularly well, but that the school children were beginning to use it to create Christmas ornaments as arts and craft projects. So what they did, they just removed the cleaning agent, they added colors, they added fresh scents. Boom, Play-Doh was born. Every home in America where you have children, trust me, you have Play-Doh. And then you look at the super glue. The list is endless. Look at how that was discovered. I think I'm going to need that. And then you flip over the page, and then you look at the Teflon, the whole mindset behind your non-stick pots. You see how it was accidentally discovered. Thanks to the inventor Plunkett in 1938. Look at that. He came back to check on his experiment in the refrigeration chamber, inspected a canister that was supposed to be full of gas. He found out that it appeared to have vanished, leaving behind only a few white flakes. He was intrigued to see this mysterious chemical beat and began at once to experiment with their properties. The new substance proved to be a fantastic lubricant with an extremely high melting point. And they began to use it at first for military gear. That was how Teflon was born. And what can you talk about pacemaker? That intrigued me because this is one great lifesaver for people that have a heart condition. Nobody set out to say, I want to invent something to regulate the beating of the heart. It was nothing but an accident. And look at Velcro. The list goes on. I was telling the church a few weeks ago, even Viagra was an accident. It's so amazing. When the medicine was made, they looked for men to try the samples of the medication on the men. They were trying to get a medication that will help in regulating the pressure of the heart for men, and then they started giving men samples, and they discovered that these men kept coming back for samples. so the person was like, why are you all coming back for samples over and over again? And that was how Viagra was born. It's amazing. And then look at the X-ray, invented by Wilhelm Röntgen. You know, he was a German physicist. He was performing a routine experiment involving cathode rays, and he noticed that a piece of fluorescent cardboard was lighting up from across the room. A thick screen had been placed between his cathode emitter and the radiated cardboard, proving that particles of light were passing through the solid objects. Amazed, he quickly found that brilliant images could be produced with this radiation. So he called his wife and said, "Lift your hand, honey," and discovered that as they passed these cathode rays, he could see clearly all of the bones and everything. Complete accidental invention. Why did I go through the pain of sharing that with you? Because there are sometimes in life, by miracles or by supernatural act of God, we hit the jackpot. We stumble on inventions. We get to a place in life where we just hit it. Somebody just goes to bed as a pauper and wakes up as a millionaire. You begin to dig your backyard and all of a sudden oil begin to gush out. Things happen in life that you just happen to be at the right place at the right time, and your life is turned around for all of eternity. They are called miracles to someone that is a believer. But you got to understand that, realistically speaking, life is governed by principles, not by accidents that happen. And the principle that every believer must live by, the principle of obedience. Read with me, everyone. If you can see it from the screen, that's great. If not, you can open your Bibles to the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 28. It's a long reading we are going to do together this morning. Deuteronomy, chapter number 28. And I would love for you to read from verse 1. We read all the way to verse 14. If you want to open your Bibles or read it from your devices, you are more than welcome to do that. Book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 28, is our last sermon series, and sermon in the series, The Blessing. And we are looking at blessing through obedience. Somebody shout amen. Amen. Let's read together, everyone. "Now it shall come to pass, if you will diligently obey the voice of the Lord your God, to observe carefully all his commandments, which I command you today, that the Lord your God will set you high above all nations of the earth, and all these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you, because you obey the voice of the Lord your God. Verse 3, blessed shall you be in the city, and blessed shall you be in the country. Blessed shall be the fruit of your body, the produce of your ground, and the increase of your herd, the increase of your cattle, and the offspring of your flocks. Verse 5, blessed shall be your basket and your kneading bowl. Blessed shall you be when you come in, and blessed shall you be when you go out. Verse 7, the Lord will cause your enemies who rise against you to be defeated before your face. They shall come out against you one way and flee before you seven ways. Verse 8, the Lord will command the blessing on you in your storehouses, with the Lord your God. Is given you. Verse 9, the Lord will establish you as a holy people to himself, just as he has sworn, if you keep the commandments of the Lord your God and walk in his ways. Then all the peoples of the earth shall see that you are called by the name of the Lord, and they shall be afraid of you. And the Lord will grant you plenty of goods in the fruit of your body, in the increase of your livestock, in the produce of your ground, in the land of which the Lord swore to your fathers to give you. The Lord will open to you his good treasures, the heavens to give the rain to your land in its season, and to bless all the work of your hand. You shall lend to many nations, but you shall not borrow. And the Lord will make you the head and not the tail. You shall be above only and not be beneath. If you heed the commandments of the Lord, for which I command you today, and are careful to observe them." Amen. 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 If you love the Lord, shout a big amen. Amen. You may have your seat, everyone. We come to this juncture where we talk about blessing coming through obedience. And I want to start by letting you know that one of the greatest things we can pass on to the upcoming generation is to pass on the godly heritage. No matter what you leave for any child, no matter what you store up for any child, no matter the financial resources, the inheritance you put in all of the banks and everywhere you can for any child, if you don't leave Christ in them, you have left them bankrupt. If you don't leave godliness in them, you have left them bankrupt. If you don't leave the fear of God, the desire and the decision to live and walk and please God, if you don't leave that in them, you have left them bankrupt. Because we all got to understand and we got to tell ourselves over and over again, it is not what you leave in their hands, it's what you leave in their hearts. It is not what you store up in the banks for them, it is what you root in their hearts. It is when they are growing up, when they know to fear God, to love God, to treat people right, to treat people with respect. How many people have all of the money in the world, but they are as rude as hell? How many people have all of the money in the world and their home is nothing to write home about? How many people have all the money in the world and they would rather not have all the money in the world because they lack peace? So we got to always remind ourselves as children of God that one of the greatest heritage we can leave in the upcoming generation is heritage of righteousness. You see, I tell people over and over again, I'm not going to promise you that when you read the word of God and you come in contact with God and you come to Redemption House and we study the word of God together, I'm not going to promise you that you're going to be a billionaire before the week is over, but I'm going to promise you that your life will not be the same. I'm going to promise you that your life is going to keep changing. I'm going to promise you that as you keep on looking at this mirror of God's word, the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 18 tells you clearly that when you look at the mirror of the world, you are changed, metamorphosized. The word in Greek is metamorpho, transformed to the same image you are looking at from glory to glory. Somebody say after me, from glory to glory. One day you're going to become exactly like Christ when he appears. But between now and then, the changes that happens in you should be continuous. The changes that happen in you should be consistent. On day by day basis, somebody must ask you, who do you look like? And you tell them, I look like Christ. Who are you trying to be like? I'm trying to be like Christ. Why are you living your life this way? Because I want to please Christ. You got to understand that for a believer living in the 21st century, the only reason you have for doing many things that you do is because you're a believer. Not because you're an American, not because you are born with silver spoon in your mouth, not because your family is very rich, not because you're black, not because you're white, not because you're from Nigeria or Trinidad, simply because you are a believer. There is something called the culture of Christianity. And that reason must suffice anyone that is trying to ask, why do you do what you do? Why do you show love? Why are you not easily angered? Why is it that you go to church every now and then? Simply because Christ lives inside of you. So you understand from the accidental discoveries that we look at, that every once in a while, God visits us with miracles. Every once in a while, things happen that changes the natural causes of events. Every once in a while, someone goes to bed and just wakes up the next morning totally different from how they went to bed the previous. Every once in a while. But you got to understand that the way we grow in Christianity is we live by principle. And there is something that I try to teach on. It's called intentional living. You do things intentionally. What do you mean, Pastor Victor? I'm saying that you pray intentionally. When you are praying, you want to be more like God. You are not praying because somebody's going to ask you, did you pray this morning? But because you want to pray, be like Jesus, you pray intentionally. You study the Bible intentionally. You are not reading it to find errors. You are not reading it to go for a debate. You are not reading it to show off. Gone are those days when people want to show off, they begin to quote one scripture after the other. And it's not the scripture that you quote is the one that changes your life that had an impact upon you. It's not the ones that you know, it's the ones that have redirected, reordered your life. One of the things the scripture does is to rearrange. And I pray that as I speak to you within the few minutes that I have, that the power of the Most High God, that His word, that is sharper than any two-edged sword, we begin to rearrange everything that has been misappropriated in your life in the name of Jesus. You come to church intentionally. You ask yourself, I'm going there because I want to feed from the word of God. I want to be a blessing to my brothers and my sisters. Tell people this. Do you know one of the reasons why we come to church? One, because we don't know it all. Do you know one of the reasons why we come to church? Because God expects that we touch one another. That is fellowship, koinonia. We don't just come to meet with God. We come to meet with one another. Because the areas of my struggles can be the areas of your victory. So I got to learn from you. How did you do it? How did you manage? How are you being victorious on a daily basis? And look at me. I'm struggling about what you already overcame. I want to learn from you. And I want you to turn to your neighbor right now and tell him or her, I want to learn from you. Or say like you mean it, I'm here to learn from you. And that is why I'm so sorry. I'm not really a cool, close friend to pastors who think they know it all. And when your pastor tells you, I know it all, I'm the custodian of all knowledge, they're just lying to you. I'm honestly appealing to you right now and apologizing on their behalf. They are lying to you. There is no one that knows it all. And you got to understand that even as custodians of his grace, that the troubles that go on the pews goes on the pulpit, and God will just bring us together to learn from one another. Don't you realize that it's easier for you to navigate your way through what someone else had already gone through and they want to lead you on the way you should pass it through than you trying to figure it all out by yourself. You come to church intentionally. You love intentionally. You teach intentionally. You give intentionally. You support intentionally. Now, this is part of the ways you cultivate a close rapport in your Christian walk with Jesus. You come to the place of prayer and say, Lord, you see me the way I am. Somebody was asking me, one of the young ladies I'm discipling now, and said, how do I talk to God? I said, talk to God like you are talking to me right now. Don't hide anything. God is not moved by all this, many of us don't even understand what we are saying. God is not moved by all of those whatever it is. Just talk to God. God, I'm weak. God, I'm feeling, acting like I'm crazy right now. I just need you to help me out right now. You know, I went to Liberia a few years ago. This is a bad joke, so if you don't want to laugh, that's okay. I went to Liberia a few years ago, and so the pastor that hosted me, she was sharing the testimony because they took me around to the ravaged areas when they had a war, totally destroyed areas, and it would probably take another generation for the country to come back to its feet, totally messed up nation. And so she was sharing with me what happened to a man, because in those days in Liberia, when the war was still severe in the land, they looked for young children, 9 years old, 8 years old, 10 years old, 12 years old, and they give them ammunition to go and start killing. And so there was a day that they all got this pastor of a church, supposedly, but just raw, down-to-earth pastor of a church, and they said, okay, say your last prayers, because we're going to blow your head off. So anyone that is opposing their own gang, they just go and kill. They just go on rampage and kill. And they said this pastor was so furious. You know, sometimes we come to church and everybody speaks the Christian language. It's when you are really faced with situations and circumstances that you speak normal language. So he said, pray your last prayer. And this pastor look at heaven. He said, God, very bad prayer. God, I'm not going to see everything because many of the words are offensive. If you F word up there, these guys are going to F my head down here. That's a prayer. That's a prayer. So God, whatever you are doing, pastoral prayer, you better don't keep F word sleeping before this. I know some of you are not going to laugh no matter how funny it is. Said this guy, true story. All these guys, they had never seen someone pray such a crazy prayer. Come and see them laughing hysterically. And that was how the guy was delivered. That was how he was delivered. You guess what? There's nothing wrong saying, God, you are omniscient, the father of all, the giver of life. And we, thy children, in humble adoration, come before you. Maybe they would have just blown his head before he started the prayers. And that's why you pray those prayers, people are impressed, but it doesn't go beyond the ceiling. just come to God the way you are. God, I messed up. How many of us are sincere enough to tell God, God, I'm weak in that area. No one knows about this. But I would rather expose it to you. The word we call exposition, expository, is the word from expose, when he exposes his word unto us. And every time God exposes his word unto us, he at least expects us to expose our lives unto him. See, God, I just cheated. I just lied. Something just crossed my heart that I didn't even know it was there. So we live intentionally. So the question that you want to ask is, what is obedience? What I'm challenging you to do today on a daily basis, you do the trivial. You live intentionally and let God handle the supernatural. So what is obedience? What is obedience? I don't want to come with a grandiose definition, but I just want you to look at it from your day-to-day lifestyle. It's submitting yourself to God's word, his instruction, and his leading. You have this great idea, and then all of a sudden you discover this is what God's word says. And you yield. You submit. You let go of your own agenda. So what is obedience? Obedience is submitting yourself, the totality of your will, to God's word, to God's instruction, and to God's leading. I'm going to be sharing some scriptural verses with you as we go on. Obedience is letting go of your ego. And oh boy, if you're an American, they have taught you from elementary school how to, you know, you are the best, you stand up, you don't bow down for no one. It's all about you. Everyone is singing your praise. So let go of your ego. Just let go. And of course, many of us men, that's one area you cannot accommodate. You can't accommodate anyone to rub on your... I mean, you can, but it's letting go of it. Now, the question I ask believers, if the Lord strip you of all that you think is important to you right now, anything that can be defined by worldly standard, will you still be joyful? Will you still be a Christian? For many of us, things define us. I was having this conversation with someone yesterday. Things define us. So when those things are gone, we're in a vacuum. Things define us. The car that we drive. Oh, do you know that guy that drives a Mercedes? That's what defines us. You know? Do you know that pastor that pastors 10 churches? Even when we come to the spiritual aspect of things, things still define us. And the last time I checked from the word of God, it's God that must define you, your relationship with him. Do you know that? Do you know that guy that has so-so and so-so job? And everybody will go, do you know that? What about, do you know that one that's trying his best to be like his master? Do you know that disciple? For the rest of our lives, that's what we do in Redemption House, to raise up disciples. To be like him. Letting go of ego. Obedience is never seeking to be number one. Never seeking to be number one. I was listening to Rick Warren preach the other day, a few weeks ago. I know I must have shared this. And he said, oh yeah, everyone knows God cannot lie. But I want to let you know something else God cannot do. It cannot be number two. It cannot be number two. And many of us come to the world with so many grandiose agenda, and we want to put God as number two. Many of us are even so spiritual that we come with all of the plans and we just ask God to rubber stamp it. And God cannot be number two. He's either the one in charge or he's totally out. What is obedience? Obedience is total conformity to God's instructions. Not in partiality, in totality. And you see, Sister Tanya, you know something? The more you obey God, the more he unfolds his will unto you. The more you obey that one, the more you unfolds his will unto you. That is why you will never come to a stage of human perfection when it comes to your relationship with Jesus. He will always be telling you something, raising up the standard. He will always be showing you what needs to be corrected about you. And oh, ye religious people that always know 1,000 things wrong with other people, it's high time you face your business and you know your life is not that great anyway. Maybe God is just trying to patch it up and cover you up with everything that you got right now, and you fail to realize that there are still things within you that needs to be changed. Something that happens when you truly read the word of God. is that you see you as you see Christ. Obedience, redemption, I'll never forget, is total conformity to God's instructions. Can I just ask you, everyone in this room, from the youngest to the oldest, what exactly is God telling you right now? Most of the time, we take a break from the hustle and the bustle, and we take a break from all of the media madness. We take a break from all of the competing voices. We take a break, and you ask, what is God saying? Because it doesn't matter who is telling you what. If that's not what God is saying, you are still setting up yourself up for a total failure. If out of respect, out of fear, or whatever it is, you decide to go on what man is telling you, what exactly is God saying? While studying in England, one of the things they told us, must have shared this before, I had the opportunity to work amongst psychiatrically challenged, or mentally ill, or whatever you call it. The first thing they told us is, if anyone tells you they are hearing voices, never tell them they are not. Because you may not be hearing what they are hearing, but if they tell you they are hearing voices, they are. And to me, it was a shock. It was a cultural shock because somebody tells you in Nigeria they are hearing voices. You're on your own. You go and hear the voices. Which voice? Which voice? You're hearing voices. May God punish the devil. Voices. When many people don't have food to eat, you are hearing voices. Voices call. That's how many of you will say. Even many of us pastors, they just take you to deliverance team. Go pray for him. You know. But he said, when anyone tells you they are hearing voices, you never tell them they are not. And I can never forget this day that someone walked into that hospital. I will not mention the name. Walked into that hospital. And I was just having a conversation with her because everything about psychiatric nursing or medical is all mostly conversational. You talk with them, you encourage them and all of that. So I was having a conversation, just getting to know her, and I discovered this lady goes to the same school that I went to, was going to write exams a few days from then. And she was just sitting down in her room and hearing voices. And she thought before she just messes everything up, she should come. If both of us are walking on the street, you would think, you wouldn't know who is hearing voices, who is not. But what am I saying? As you are seated here, voices in the atmosphere. Voices everywhere. As a believer, you got to be tuned to God's frequency to say, that is God. Because sometimes it may look so good, but if that is not God, still setting up yourself up for destruction. And many of us, every once in a while, we have done something simply because we think that's good. That's what everyone approves of. And then you get stuck. So the obedience is conforming yourself to God's instruction. And many times as believers, we want to make the word of God malleable to our situation. And that is why anything you want to do as a believer, you're going to get a scriptural verse to back yourself up. Oh, anything you want to do. Abraham had two wives, so if that's the father of faith, so what is my own? Even Abraham had two wives. God help you, the one that you have married. Anything you want to do that is outrageously ungodly or in a very minute way lacks sense, you find reasons. You find people that have done that in the Bible and with some of them, they did it and they didn't get hurt. But is that what God is asking you to? Obedience is total conformity. God wants you to conform. God wants you to conform. God wants you to conform, which simply means you are bad today, you're going to be better tomorrow. He wants you to conform. That's one of the greatest mysteries of what the scripture does in our lives. Romans chapter 12 verse 2. Be ye not conformed to the world, but instead of the conformity to the world, be conformed. But the word that was used was what? Transformed. The same word. Metamorpho in Greek. Metamorphosize. And is the best way is to look at the butterfly that goes from the egg to the caterpillar to the larva to the pupa to the butterfly. Be transformed. Every stage of your life, as I'm preaching to you this morning, you may not know it, but transformation is taking place. But you got to allow the Holy Spirit to do that perfect work. Many of us, we are half-baked, and we are in so much of a hurry to show ourselves to the world. Some of us are still supposed to be in the cocoon. You hearing me, Redemption House? Supposed to still be in the cocoon. I say, God, deal with it, deal with it. Well, some of us always want to rush out, always want to rush out. Many times I want to preach and God is saying, no, that's not for no one. That's for you. That's for you. I'm still handling that. Let me take care of that. Because everyone wants to share a big revelation, a big deal. Stay in the cocoon and let him do the perfect work. The Lord is blessing you. Can you shout amen?
Amen.
Obedience is observing carefully what God says and having the readiness to do them. You observe carefully. You observe carefully. And it's not everyone that's going to be a pastor. It's not everyone that's going to be an evangelist. But God expects every of his children to walk in obedience. To walk in obedience. And this morning I'm speaking on blessing through obedience. You want the blessing, you walk a walk of obedience. And you may say, Pastor, but there are some people that are living in disobedience and they are getting blessed. Oh, that's what the world called blessed. When we look at what the church or what the Christian, the biblical definition of obedience is, that's not a blessing when you get it and you are walking in disobedience. No. As a matter of fact, many things we call blessing, the Bible says that God gives it unto the unrighteous just to set them up for the day of judgment. And I don't want a blessing that people, or I don't want a provision that people call blessing that is just setting me up for destruction. You want the blessing? You must never forget these five cultures. Everyone in this room needs to have a culture of obedience. We drive it in. A culture is what you cultivate, what you become. Some people call it tradition. Some people call it the way of life. So that means every once in a while you may miss the mark. Every once in a while you may go astray. Every once in a while you don't feel like coming to church. Thank you. Thank you, Simon. Every once in a while you think you know it all. Every once in a while you get full of yourself. But you still come back and you say, Lord, 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 I'm so sorry. You still come back on track. Don't you realize that every time we miss the mark, it always provides opportunity for us to come back to the track? Let me tell you this, and it will blow your mind. You remember where the Bible says, run the race that is set before you with patience. The race set before you. Where is that in the scriptures again, Ephesians? Is it run the race? No, Hebrews. That is set before you. Hebrews chapter 12? Yes. The race that is set before you. Run the race that is set before you. Run the race that is set before you. And what the only thing that will make you to run that race that is set before you is obedience. Run the race that is set before you. You know what happened, Sister Carol? What we call Olympic now, in the Roman Empire, it's all about when they used to have these gladiators fight in the Colosseum. Say that again. Yeah, they just have that show and everybody comes and all of that. But you know, the Greek polished it a little bit. For a student of history, I think every preacher should go and learn history. For a student of history, the idea of the Olympics started with the Greeks. Started with the Greeks. It was the Greeks' idea. When the Greek polished the idea of having people, gladiators, fight in the Colosseum, they have what is called agon. That is what we call in contemporary English language a stadium. It's called agon. And then they will invite people and they have different categories of people come and compete. And what people are competing in is called agonia. Agonia in Greek, which is called agony in English. So people will come and say, oh, I'm here. Competing in agonia, which agonia, running, which agonia, jumping, which agonia, this. And everyone will have their own groups of agonia, which they are competing in. Are you still with me? Are you still with me? You see, the child grows by teaching, so stay with me. When the Bible says, running the race that was set before you, the Greek word used was agonia. It's set before you. It's not going to be comfortable, honey. There are some things you want to have, you're not going to be able to have. Some places you want to go, you're not able to go. Some ways you want to speak or dress, that race is set before you. You're not competing with anyone. You're competing with yourself. It's agonia, honey. You got to do everything to stay in the lane. Check off the excesses. Every once in a while, you think you're competing with someone else. So you feel, well, I even go to church 4 times in a week. They only come once in a year. Honey, you're competing with yourself. It is that is set before you. Hallelujah. Culture of obedience. You want the blessing? You need a culture of faith. You want the blessing? You need a culture of service. You want the blessing? You need a culture of humility. You want the blessing? You need a culture of contentment. Pretty much, number one branches out to 2 to 5. That if you are ready to walk in total obedience to Christ, it will be easy to have the faith in the one that you are obeying. It will be easy to serve. It will be easy to exercise humility. It will be possible to live in contentment. It's one of the things that is missing in our Christian culture. Is obedience. Everyone in this room must have heard this verse of the Bible before, and don't forget it. Don't forget it. 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 22. Everyone in this room must have preached on it or read it. And the question is, in your life right now, what exactly does God want? Samuel was generous. Samuel said, 1 Samuel 15:22, has the Lord as much delight in burnt offerings, in sacrifices, as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, redemption house to obey is better than sacrifice, to heed than the fold of rams. Every time we tell you to give offerings and make sacrifices, there is something always higher than all of that. Because your offerings are great, your sacrifices are wonderful. Nothing wrong with all of the offerings. Nothing is wrong with all of the sacrifices. But for a close walk with God, obedience is the key. You bring all of the offerings, you make all of the sacrifices, and you still live in disobedience, forget it. You cannot enjoy the blessing. So I want you to always remember Redemption House. Offerings are great. Bring them millions. Sacrifices, yeah, excellent. Every once in a while, tell your boss, I'm not coming today. I need to make a sacrifice. Our church is going out on the street. I need to make an impact. But at the end of it all, your walk will be judged by your level of obedience. As I bring this to a close, let me share with you some scriptural verses. And as we do that, we're going to pray. As we do that, you're going to let this word become flesh. Let this word be real in your life. Let me first of all share with you the book of Leviticus, chapter number 23. You write them down if you can. We look at some of the blessings that obedience brings. Leviticus chapter 23, 26 from verse 3 to verse 10. It says something like this. It said, if you walk in my statutes and you keep my commandments to carry them out, then I will give you rains in their season. And everyone in this room, I want to speak to your life that the rain of heaven began to come upon your life. Yes. There are many of us that are going through so much dryness right now. You don't just know what is going on. You need rain. You need rain. Many of us have put a lot of seed on the ground. And it looks like everything is just barren. Don't you see within the past 1 week how you are driving around and the trees began to blossom? I was telling my wife, and you see the colors again and the flowers simply because it began to rain. I decree in the name of the Lord Jesus that in this season it will begin to rain in your life. Yes. Your family will witness rain. Yes. Your investment will witness rain. Yes. Where others declare that there is a casting down, you will say there is a lifting. Get up on your feet. We are praying already. He said, if you obey the Lord, it will cause rain. Somebody prayed this morning and said, Lord, I receive abundance of rains. And I was so intrigued because it was put rains in plural. Rains all over me. In the name of Jesus, spiritual rains, financial rains. A control room plays something in the background. I receive rains all over. Rains in my family. Rains in my finances. In my walk with God. In my ministerial assignment. I will never walk in dryness. Somebody pray with me, honey. And said, I receive rains. Enough of hardship. Enough of failure. Enough of all this living in the quagmire of confusion. And I need rain right now. Somebody help me. I need rain right now in the name of Jesus. I enjoy abundance of rain. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name we pray. Are you ready to pray? Let me read that verse to you. So that the land will yield its produce. I pray for you this morning that the land begin to yield its produce unto you. I pray that the land begin to yield its produce unto you. You see, everything that man had ever used above ground, they were all buried underground. Everything. Everything, the car that you drive, even the money that you spend. I still want my PowerPoint after you play. Everything the man had ever made that had used above ground, they were all hidden underground. Everything, your computer, the money, what it is to make money, trees, all hidden underground. Somebody pray with me this morning. That I command that the ground begin to yield its produce unto me. In the name of Jesus. Every produce that I need that is locked up in the ground, I receive abundance of its provision. Right now. Somebody pray with me. Will you? In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Divine provision. The Lord, you begin to make a way for me where there is no way. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we'll pray. Let me show you the book of Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 24. It says, so the Lord commanded us to obey, to observe all these statutes, to fear the Lord our God for our good always. I read that again this morning and I'm like, wow. So what God wants to do in my life is that every season I will experience goodness. Everything will just work for my good always. For my survival. That everything will work for my good always. You don't understand what that means. Everything will work for my good always. There will be no day where you are lacking in health or lacking in help. Everything working for your good. You are going to a place and God had already gone ahead to take care of everything. Every detail. You walk into places and you are walking into miracles. You know, there are some people on the face of the earth, they said anything they touch is gold. It's gold because there is a divine hand of the Most High working on their behalf. I pray that the Lord will be good unto you always. I pray that the Lord will be good unto you always. You know, Psalm 23 said, goodness and mercy shall follow me all of the days of my life. So when you walk in obedience, goodness and mercy will always be there. Let me read to you Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 1 to 2. It says, it will be if you diligently obey the Lord your God, being careful to do all his commandments that I command you, the Lord your God will set you on high. Hold somebody's hand. And I wanted to begin to pray upon their life. That whatever you are right now, I don't know whether you are at a pinnacle of success or you are just about to begin. I decree the Lord begin to set you on high. In the name of Jesus, greater heights than you have ever witnessed. Let the Lord begin to set you on high. Somebody, can you pray with me? If you understand that, that God has put you as a prophet upon that life, the Lord begin to set you on high. In the name of Jesus, the Lord begin to set you on high. In the name of Jesus, the Lord begin to set you on high. 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 Every plan of the enemy to make you remain on this platform forever, that will not prosper. There is a lifting coming your way. There is a rising in your future. The hand of God is propelling you to greater heights. Greater heights than you had ever known. In ministry, in family, in finances, in your walk with God, greater heights. Receive that grace this morning to go higher and higher, higher and higher. You will not be defeated by the powers of darkness. Yeah, let the Lord set you on the pedestal where the powers of the enemy can never reach you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name we pray. Bring it down. Let me read to you the book of Deuteronomy chapter 30. Deuteronomy 30 verse 9 to 10. It said, then the Lord your God will prosper you abundantly in all the work of your hand. Say to that person whose hand you just held, he said, the Lord will prosper you abundantly. 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 Shout it like you mean it. The Lord will prosper you abundantly. Shout it like you mean it. The Lord will prosper you abundantly. The Lord will prosper you abundantly. Receive abundance of prosperity. Receive abundance of prosperity. Receive abundance of prosperity. You believe it, shout a big amen. Amen. The Bible says in Leviticus chapter 18 verse 5, so you shall keep my statutes and my judgments by which a man may live. I want you to hold somebody's hand and I want you to begin to pray upon that life. I command that everything within you begin to live right now. I destroy the power of death over your life. I destroy the power of death over your relationship. I destroy the power of death over your family. I destroy the power of death over your ministry. In the name of Jesus, as you walk in obedience, begin to live, begin to enjoy the fullness of God's provision. Receive the life of God, the Zoe, the life of God, to walk stronger and stronger in the name of Jesus. You begin to walk upon your high places in the name of the Lord. Begin to pray upon the life. You will not die, but you will live to declare the glory of the Lord in the land of the living. Hallelujah. 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 Let me just see if we can do one more. Somebody shout a big amen.
Amen.
Let me wrap it up showing you the book of Isaiah chapter 1 verse 19. Very beautiful scripture. Isaiah 1 19 says, if you are willing and obedient, you will eat. Some version says the good of the land. Some other version says the best of the land. Let me tell you something. Every land has its bad, the ugly, and every land has its best. So the Bible says, as you walk in obedience, you will eat the best of the land. Anywhere you are right now, God wants you to eat the best of the land. Amen. Do me a favor, hold somebody's hand so tight. And I wanted to pray for him or her and do it for a minute. And say, wherever you are right now, wherever the Lord is taking you, begin to eat the best of that land. Let that land begin to yield its fruits and increase unto you. Can you pray with me, beloved? You eat the best of the land. The best of the land is your portion. God has not put you here to be a manager. He has put you here to enjoy every provision that he has made. God has not put you here to struggle from pillar to post. He has put you here to enjoy all of the provisions that he has made. Enjoy the best of the land. Don't get quiet on me. You have a few seconds more. Enjoy the best of the land. I want you to begin to pray. Let the land open up unto you. Let the land open up unto you. Let the land open up unto you. The Lord has brought you here to be an overcomer over this land. The Lord has brought you here to conquer. The Lord has brought you. Maraba Shendaya Riba Krego Tali Vriena Ros Kibra Nikaida Rotali Egrinan Yarebo Sundia. Let the land open unto you. Let the land open unto you. Let the land open unto you. Let the land. Let the land open unto you. Let the land open unto you. Let the land open unto you. Let the land yield and increase unto you. Let the land bring its best unto you. Begin to pray upon that life. You will not struggle to eat. You will not struggle to live. Let the land yield its increase unto you. You will not struggle to eat. You will not struggle to live. Begin to pray upon that life. Struggle is taken out of your 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 life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Struggle is taken out of your life. No more struggles. No more pain. No more affliction. You're set at liberty. Receive that grace this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. I'm going to ask you to pray one more time. Like I told you, it's
is our last message on the series on the blessing. You know, Sister Obey, I read this passage about the spies going to spy out the land of Canaan a few years ago, and I just, my mind was just blown apart. It said that they got to the valley called Sheol. Got to the valley, and then it said they brought grapes from that valley. Is this Eskol? Eskol or something? They brought grapes, and the Bible says to carry the grapes, they needed a pole on the shoulders of two soldiers carrying the grapes. Say, wow. We're not talking about the kind of grapes you go to the supermarket and you, yes, no, no. Let's take one. No. These grapes were so big and heavy that it would need two soldiers to carry it on a pole. And those guys said, let's make sure you walk through the desert and show the people this is what God has prepared for you. You know, unbelief still hindered them from enjoying that. But I said, wow, what a land. What a land. I just want to speak faith unto you this morning. And I want to remind you based on the word of God that where God is bringing you to, it will take soldiers and a pole to carry the grapes. The blessings will blow your mind. They said we go to a land, the land is flowing with milk and honey. They said everyone in that land looks so well built. They all look like basketball players. They said the sons of Anak, the word Anak translates to the word neck in Hebrew. These guys are so tall that no matter how try you, how do you try to look at them, they're just way taller. So the descendants of Anak were in the land. God wants to bring you to a land, to a place in your life where abundance will become the norm, where promotion will be a daily occurrence, where it will not be difficult to serve God. So can I just do something? Can I pray for you as you lift up your hands? Lord, I ask that the mighty hands of Jesus begin to touch these hands. I pray, Lord, that by the virtue of your word, by the virtue of your presence in this house this morning, that you will take sorrow out of these lives. I declare that these lives are delivered from all manner of oppression. In the name of Jesus, I ask, Lord, that you will open the windows of heaven and you will cause there to be abundance of rain upon every life, upon every family. Abundance of rain upon their ministry. That, Lord of God, the maximum that your people had witnessed up until now will be nothing compared to the minimum that will happen right after now. I pray that you will open the treasures that are stored even in the deepest parts of the earth. I ask, I decree today that in the name of the Lord Jesus, for you the windows of heaven are open, the cisterns of the earth are broken. Receive abundance of rain in the name of Jesus. I declare that the Lord God, that is the way maker, that is the joy giver, begin to work on your behalf. No good thing will be withheld from you in the name of Jesus. As you walk in the world, you will not walk alone. You will not walk in darkness. You will not walk in shame. Receive abundance. Receive provision. Receive promotion. In the name of the Lord Jesus. The Bible says, they that love the Lord spoke to one another. Malachi 3:16. He said, the Lord heard and a book of remembrance was opened for them. I decree this morning that a book of remembrance had been opened for you. I decree the Lord your God had remembered you for good. The Lord had remembered you for favor. In the name of Jesus. Every seed that you have sown in the ground, let them begin to produce abundance of harvest. In the name of Jesus. But Jesus said to the disciples, he said, I have sent you to go and harvest where you have not sown. I declare that as you are released from this service this morning, that even in the places where you have not sown, let abundance of harvest begin to come upon you. Receive harvest of financial blessings, harvest of sound health, harvest of open doors, harvest of victory all around, harvest of promotion, harvest of a balanced Christian living, harvest of the overflow of anointing. Receive it now. Father, we thank you. We give you praise. We give you glory. May I please request that everyone come as we observe the table of the Lord together. We're going to do that before we give our offerings. And tell everyone, can you please come as we observe the communion together this morning. And as you do that, I want you to come with prayers in your heart. Let's do it as quickly as we can. Everyone, please come. Everyone, please come. Everyone, please come. Hallelujah. Everyone, please come. I'm waiting for the last person to get here. Hallelujah. Please come. Sister Bay, please come. Let's come to the front, everyone. Come. Thank you. God bless you. Yes, let the children come as well. So it's a privilege to come before the table of the Lord. We did this throughout times of resurrection up until now. Said, that which I received from the Lord, I give to you. That the same night when Jesus was crucified, he took the bread and he broke it. And Father, we thank you for this element set before us. We come in obedience to your word that you said we should do this in remembrance of you. That as we partake of this element, let your life flow into us. In Jesus' name we pray. Hallelujah. When you receive the element, just start praying and start praying in it. Make sure that everyone has the element. Just pass it on to my brother. I think it's going to go around. I'm on that cross as Jesus died. The wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ, I live. I think everyone got it. So we're waiting for everyone to open it up. Hallelujah. Did you get the bread?
Stand in victory.
Father, we thank you for your body that was broken for us. It was such a great privilege to be called your own. Lord, we just thank you We thank you for this identity that we have in you. Be exalted forevermore, O God. So the same night they took the bread and they broke it and they said, take ye, eat, for this is my body that was broken for you. Can we take it, partake of the bread together? And the scripture says, in the same manner, after the supper, he took the cup and he blessed it and said, this is the cup of my new covenant, the blood of my new covenant that was shed for you. But I will not drink it with you again until I drink it new in my Father's kingdom. We thank you, Lord, for your blood saves, your blood washes, your blood purifies. And as we identify with this blood that speaks better things than the blood of Abel, we ask, Lord, in us will flow the riches of your glory. In us will flow, O God, your life. And through us this week as we walk out of this room, will flow the gospel, will flow the life of Jesus to everyone that we come in contact with. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shall we partake of the blood together? Lord, I thank you as we lay down on Calvary everything that had followed us to this place this morning. I thank you, Lord, for even the grace to witness the last Sunday in the month of April. Thank you for the months ahead of this year. Thank you for all that you have promised to do, you will do. Be exalted in us, O God. I want everyone to stay where you are. I don't know if there's anyone here you've not made a commitment to surrender your life to Jesus. Everyone, just stay where you are. Stop whatever you are doing. Thank you. Just stay where you are. I want all eyes closed, please. All eyes closed. Is anyone here you've never made a commitment to surrender your life to Jesus? And God brought you here this morning and you want to say, Jesus, I just wanted to come into my life. And probably anyone watching Facebook or YouTube as well, you want to make that commitment. If someone is here and just want to pray that prayer, and just make the Lord of your life. Just lift up your hands. I'm going to pray with you. Just raise those hands. I'm going to pray with you. And if there's anyone watching, you want to make that commitment, just say these simple words after me. Father, I thank you for this opportunity to hear that you love me today. I surrender my life to you. I ask you to come into my life. I believe that you died and rose again for me. So today, I completely surrender my life to you. Help me to live for you for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We thank God today for, you know, this series that has now